So it's a great tragedy that as I've gotten older, there's an expectation that I make sense, because I've sort of made a career out of not making sense, or at least making nonsense. And so it's interesting because, like, you know, the idea that I could give you advice, and I'm speaking to all of you as adults because you are, and by the way, you're very special, each of you. And what's interesting to me is that probably 70% of you think that I'm lying when I say that you're special, and I really hope you figure out a way to get over that quickly. And it leads into what I want to talk about, because any sort of advice that I would give you right now about technology or strategy is probably not going to apply to your careers, because everything is going to have changed by then. But the one thing that'll be constant is your inner emotional life as you struggle to be creative and to be passionate and things like that. And so that's sort of what I wanted to focus on. And one of the difficulties that you're going to find, and that was a really nice question there, and those guys were charming. There was a nice question there, which was, do you have a piece of advice that will get me to my goal, right? And there's this curious psychological concept called hindsight bias. Hindsight bias is when someone who's successful tells the story of their success based on the things that they had control over, right? So they credit their success to certain choices that they made, and then they say, that's why I'm successful. But the truth is that the story of careers and lives are not straight lines. And I'll sort of tell you, my career. Right now I'm the president of Buzzfeed Motion Pictures, and that sounds very impressive, right? A very quick trajectory of the line, and you can tell me whether it's straight or not. In high school, I studied art. I was sort of a loner outside kid. I hit university and I studied neuroscience. Towards an advanced degree right after college, I quit and I joined a rock band, and I toured for 5 years. When my drummer decided to go to medical school, the band fell apart, and I was unemployed. I got employed as a temp worker answering phones in a Spanish language department of an insurance agency, and I don't speak Spanish. So I illustrated the dogs and babies of other phone workers in exchange for them answering the phone for me. I decided that I should be an illustrator, and I bought a computer with a credit card and taught myself computer graphics, and then was hired as a temporary illustrator for an advertising firm, who then promoted me to art director because they needed art directors, not because I was talented. I then used the coding experience that I had from neuroscience to start making animated websites and things like that. And because of that, I got a random weird viral hit in 2001. Where I had filmed myself dancing to Madonna's Justify My Love, put it online as part of a birthday invitation called How to Dance Properly. 40 million people saw it. And then I quit my job and decided that was the only thing that I was interested in. For the next 3 years, I worked my butt off in radical poverty to the point where I got very depressed. And then I started to make videos. In 2006, I had a show which is sort of a very early form of a video blog called The Show with Zay Frank, which became very, very popular, and it started a speaking career for me. Then I got very depressed. I moved to Los Angeles, had a brief stint with Hollywood, decided that I would go to law school, decided not to go to law school. Then I started a company, which was a social games company. It didn't go so well, but I pivoted into video again, and that was when I was bought by BuzzFeed, and then I became the president of BuzzFeed Motion Pictures. Hindsight bias would be, so you should all study neuroscience in college if you want to be the president of a motion picture company. The point is that it's actually very, very difficult to find any piece of advice that will last you a long time. And so as we turn inward and you think, I know that probably some of you are searching so hard for a mantra that will carry through your creative life, right? I mean, I remember in high school, I had little mantras that I would stick because I was very socially awkward, very anxious, and had a terrible time. And I would have little post-its and I would say, today you will smile more. And I would, why? Yeah. And then the next day, I would apologize more. Maybe that's going to work. And I would say sorry about everything, right? And I would just try it out. And over the span of my creative life, I've had many of these, right? There's not just a single one. I tried become undeniable. Right? So that just meant, like, you will work harder than everyone. You will make so much content that if they ignore you, you won't care. You'll have stuff to point to. If when they finally discover you and they have a criticism, well, you should try this, you say, I already tried it. Thank you very much. Right? And interestingly, that strategy, the undeniable strategy, came from the fact when I worked in that advertising company for a very brief amount of time, I worked for a creative director who would stay up all night twice a week, work right through the night, and I would do it with him. And I was like, this is amazing. This is what I guess you're supposed to do in your early 20s, just like work like this, right? And I even afterwards, I taught at NYU, and I taught a course about becoming undeniable, and I would have them work on every day they had a project, every week there was a weekly project, and they had semester projects simultaneously. Right? Ridiculous amounts of work. And only after did I find out that my creative director had a drug problem. So the mantras themselves come from spurious places. After that, I had, what would the superhero me do? Right? And that guided me for a little while. Currently, I'm in a phase where I'm thinking about choose a number and make it go up. Right? Because it's an actually interesting way of thinking about your life. It's like, you know, you say, oh, you know, my social life, I really feel like it's not doing well. Oh, choose a number. The number of friends that you have dinner with each week. And I say, how many is that now? Okay, that's two. Let's get it up to four. Right? It's actually a very kind of interesting strategy, but I don't think that one's going to last me that long. And the point is that internally, you have to be a little bit forgiving. Right? You can't get into anxiety states about not having found the thing that's going to carry you forward. You're a complex, special, very strange, awfully complicated individual. And you change over time, too. So give yourself a break on that. There's a non-linearity to careers and to life. And don't trust people that try to tell you there's one thing. They're crazy. The next thing that I wanted to point to is there's a wonderful book. There are books out there about the creative life, and creative life can be film, it can be art, it can be business, it can be all these things. The internal creative life is just what propels you forward in your life. There are some books. The Creative Habit by Twyla Tharp is one. Another one is on writing, and it's called Bird by Bird by Anne Lamott. And Anne Lamott has this wonderful concept in there, which is simple. It's just make sure you love what you're actually going to be doing in your career. If you're a writer, you should like the tapping of the keys or the pencil in your hand. Don't base your career on these false ghosts of success in the future as the thing that's going to drive you. If you spend all your time writing and hating writing, but are propelled forward by the moment that you get a book deal or in a signing line, you say, oh, thank you so much, yes. And you sign your signature. If those fantasies propel you forward, you're probably in the wrong career. You have to love the thing. If you're an accountant, you should love spreadsheets, right? I mean, there's actually no other reason to love accounting. money, actually, would be the other reason, and that's a false ghost as well. There's also a concept called brain crack, which I'm super obsessed with, which is sometimes we say to ourselves, we have a concept in our mind, which is like the thing that we're gonna do. Like, yeah, I mean, I'm doing this stuff right now, but in the future, I'm gonna write this novel, and I've been working on it in my head, but I don't have the time to really dedicate to it yet, but at some point, I'm really gonna have the time, and I'm gonna flesh it out, and you build it up in your mind, and the problem is that you will never have that time. And you are propelling yourself forward internally by some false little ghost, and it feels good when you come back to it, and you're like, you have a bad day, and you're like, well, at some point I'm gonna write this novel, and it's gonna be pretty awesome, and internally you start feeling kinda nice about that. That's called brain crack. The problem is that the first time that you do something, it's gonna suck. So get it out quickly. Get the suck out. Do it. Get the brain crack out of your head and just start doing the thing, because the first three are going to stink, right? And that is the sort of real realization of the creative process, is trusting that you're gonna have more great ideas, and that through the process of getting the work out of your body and into the real world is the real challenge of any sort of creative life. The next piece of this, and you can have this first slide on screen, by the way, if there is one. Oh, perfect. The next piece of this is that you have to care for your emotional self. There is a few fallacies about creative processes, and one is people start believing that depression and creativity are somehow intrinsically linked. That is a lie. In my life, in my career, I associated anxiety to creativity. In other words, if I wasn't radically anxious, I thought that I wasn't being creative, and I would stir up anxiety. I'd be like, oh my gosh, you're not doing enough, you're not doing enough, right? And if I didn't have that like radical fear and horror inside my body, I would think that I was underperforming. That is a lie that anxiety told me about my creativity. Creativity is not a part of any of those emotional sets, but it's your job to untangle them over time. If you feel bad, it's not okay. You have to get help with that. You have to talk to people about it. You have to try to separate out that bad feeling from your life and your creative life. Otherwise, you'll be like me, who in their later life spends all of their time untangling that anxiety, that depression, from the rest of my life, which is unfortunate because I'm successful and I should be enjoying it, right? And instead, I go to therapy a lot. So the last thing that I want to say is that you are incredibly special, and your internal experience about the world, the emotions you feel, all those things are very important. And this slide is a reminder to me that one of the gifts of the modern age that you've been born into is that you don't have to be alone anymore. Or the other way of saying it is that the things that make you feel the most alone have the greatest power to connect you to other people who also think that they're feeling alone, that they're the only people that feel that way. I think about it every time I type something into Google. I type in, why is there a pain? And it auto-completes in my left side, all these things, right? And I'm like, oh my gosh, there's other hypochondriacs out there, right, that are Googling why things are wrong with their body instead of going to the doctor. You know, and there's something beautiful about that, and you can roll these aspects of your experience in life into the media that you create, into the work that you create. And I'm just going to show you, as I leave, a piece that I did with the actor Harry Shum. He's a dancer, he was in Glee, and he approached me and he said, I want to do a dance to your voice. And I said, yes. What's it going to be about? And he said, I don't know. And I said, well, what's something about you? And he said, I had a rough childhood. And I said, oh, tell me about it. And he said, I can't. I don't want to. But I was shy and bullied. And so I wrote a script in which I imagined what his life was like. And he changed one line in it. And then he danced to it. And I'll play that and say goodbye. We have to go to the next slide. Not
hey,
that one.
Cheyenne,
not that one. This one.
This is Harry. As a boy, Harry was very, very shy. Some people might have even said that he was painfully shy, as if his shyness caused them pain and not the other way around. There are many things that can cause a person to recede, to look away from other people's eyes, or to choose empty hallways over crowded ones. Some shy people try to reach out, and try, and nothing seems to come back. And then there's just a point where they stop trying. In Harry's case, he was slapped in the face and called names designed to isolate him, designed to deliver maximum damage. This because he'd come from another country and didn't know the right words to use or the right way to say them. And so, Harry learned how to be still, to camouflage, to be the least. Some people describe this as receding into a shell where the stillness hardens and protects. But the eyes, even when they look down and away, are still watching, still looking for some way out or in, painfully shy. Then, in middle school, Harry found theater, where he forced himself to speak through other people's words, and then dance, where he started to speak through the movements of his body. To be so still for so long when you're young means a lot of pent-up energy, and it was released there through work, endless work. If someone carves into a sapling with a knife, the injury is as wide as the entire trunk. Though that mark will never fully heal, you can grow the tree around it, and as you grow, the scar gets smaller in proportion. If you, right now, are in a shell, you should know that you're not alone, that there are many, many other people like you, and that there's nothing wrong with you. It might even be necessary right now. It might keep you safe for a time. But after the danger is gone, and after it's exhausted its use, you'll find a way out. You may need help. You might need to work pretty hard. You may need to find some ways to laugh at yourself. Or find a passion or a friend. But you will find it. And when you do, it will be so good to see you. This is Harry. As a boy, Harry was very, very shy.
Thank you very much, and good luck. Oh, I'm sorry. Thought I could sneak off.
Thank you very much. That's wonderful. Just a couple quick questions. So, neuroscience, rocker, movie maker, have you got itchy feet? Can you give us any hints what the future could hold?
Well, So my current project is Buzzfeed Motion Pictures. We put out 43 short form pieces a week, plus some medium form scripted stuff and other divisions branded, working with wonderful people. But those are cool. The thing that I'm trying to do is create the studio that. That if somebody, you know, if somebody went to their parent and said, "I want to be an actor," right? I'm sure parents here would be like, "Ooh, okay," right? Because it's a rough life, and if, you know, in Hollywood, you see it's a giant toilet that flushes people down into despair. So I want to create a studio that is more modern aligned, right? Where you can come in to a place that has resources and has equipment and has collaborators, and you literally walk in the door and 2 days later you're making videos and it's an incubator, and has the kind of excitement that I think comes out of an entire generation that has expectations about making stuff, getting data back, making more stuff, interacting with audiences, which is so opposite to what Hollywood is. Hollywood is like, you have an idea, somebody hooks you up with somebody, then some money is raised, and then you get some notes from somebody who has never made a thing in their lives, and then you're asked to, you know, do stuff, and then like 2 years later, you know, maybe something goes to air. And it's just, it's so slow, and so not like, you know, what the modern reality is. And so that's what's really exciting for me.
Well, that's
I want to open
exciting.
A cheese farm.
Of course.
Some point,
I mean, you know? there had to be one more. Last question, you talked about, you know, you failed the first time, the second time, the third time. What were the videos you made then before the 40 million hits?
Oh, yeah. I mean, everything's online in some capacity. It's all terrible. I mean, really, I think that a majority of what I've done has been failure in one form or another. But I tend not to look at the world like that. I mean, you know, if you judge media or judge product at face value, if you just look at it as the thing, you miss the point, because usually that thing is a signal that someone is trying underneath it, and that's the beauty of the network. The, you know, in my era, when I was a teenager, like, nobody knew what fonts were. There weren't word processors, and like, you know, there was suddenly like MySpace. You probably know the modern version, but the first version was terribly ugly because people were just trying all kinds of stuff. They'd paste code into it and the pages would break, and everyone was making fun of how ugly it was. But for me, it was like incredible. I was like, people know what Helvetica is now? Like, that's incredible. And like, people are actually, you know, growing up with the expectation that they can modify their surroundings, and to the point that your generation, like, you know, you will probably print your shoes in the next 5 years. Like, that should, it'll be a reasonable expectation. You'll be like, I don't like my shoes, I'm gonna go print one. And that's just, that's a radical, radical transformation, and it has less to do with the aesthetics of form, but rather the aesthetics of expectation, of creativity, of permission, yeah.
Well, thank you so much. I hope you hang around maybe for a bit of the day. If you want to ask, say any questions, tackle him, please, later. But
you were looking at me when you said, do you want to ask, say any questions, which became very confusing. My mind is blown. Thank you very much.